So if you're talking about one qubit, then it can be in 0 and 1. If we have n qubits, then they can be in superposition of 2 to power n different basis states simultaneously, that I will tell. So timing, you understand that it's a different kind of phenomena which is based on qubits and different properties of quantum mechanics, that is superposition and entanglement. And these two properties give quantum parallelism, or the speed at which we claim that quantum computer can do certain tasks faster than the classical one, is because of these two properties, superposition and entanglement, which we will see in the following slides. So as we already told that this quantum computer operates on qubits, which are basically the hardware, and there is this quantum gate operation. Similar to the classical gate operation, we have quantum gates which are applied on the qubits over the period of time. So any quantum algorithm or classical, also we understand that in classical what we have some bits and we apply some classical gates and we implement our algorithm and get the results. So same thing happen in quantum also. We have quantum algorithms which have a fixed sequence of elementary quantum gate operations. So we initialize the qubits, we apply these quantum gates and implement our quantum algorithm, and then we finally measure our output. So on measurement, what happens is that on measurement, the n qubit can be in quantum system, it can be in 2 to power n possible basis states simultaneously. But once you measure it, you will get one of them with certain probability that we will see. So the thing is here is to understand that the quantum algorithms, similar to the classical algorithm, we do some initialization and we do some gate operation and then we measure. Okay, but in quantum system, in between, the system can be in superposition of 2 to power n basis states. Okay, on measurement we will get one of them. So let's go with this two important property, entanglement, superposition. So superposition, as the name suggests, that a single qubit can be in superposition, or basically you can say linear combination of both 0 and 1. So let's say phi is a single qubit state, then it is linear combination of both 0 and 1. Okay, so, and the condition here is that this alpha and beta are the amplitudes of state 0 and state 1. And the condition there is that the mod alpha square plus mod beta square should be 1. So here this mod alpha square is nothing but the probability of measuring qubit phi as 0. So what is this mod alpha square? It is probability of getting 0 on measurement. So as I told that in quantum system, it can be in both 0 and 1 simultaneously. But once you measure it, you will get either 0 or 1 with this probabilities. Mod alpha square probability is there that we can get 0. Mod beta square probability that we can get 1. And this probability sum should be 1. So mod alpha square plus mod beta square should be 1. So here we are seeing in the 1 qubit system, if we generalize it for n qubit, then you will be able to appreciate what is the benefit we are getting here. So let's so is this thing clear? So the thing here is to understand that this alpha and beta are the amplitude of 0 and 1 state, okay, and this mod alpha square mod beta square the probabilities of getting 0 and 1 on measurement. Okay, so as I told already that on measurement either we will get 0 or 1. So these are the probabilities. Okay, so let's generalize it for n qubit system. So suppose there are small n qubits. So in case of, okay, let's write it like this. So if there are n qubits, then how many basis states will be there? There will be basis states like this. So it will be basically 0, 0, 0, n times 1. So here I'm writing this thing in decimal. Basically, it is like this 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, and there will be this n minus 1 will be what? 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So So the thing here is that this thing I have written as a decimal number 0, 1, 2 up to n minus 1. And the condition here is that small n is the number of qubits. So then there will be 2 to power n states, basis states will be there. So suppose if we have, so in that case also, you can write this n qubits as a superposition of all these basis states that are here, capital N minus 1. So you can write them as a linear combination. So this phi n qubits can be in superposition of all these basis states. Those are basically 2 to power n states. It can be simultaneously. So let's understand with an example of 3 qubit resistor. Then it will be more clear. Suppose I have a system with 3 qubit. Let's call it phi 3. Then it can be in superposition of 000. 001 10 110 111. So what I'm saying here is, yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, please. Yeah, please. Any question is there? Am I audible? Vidya ma'am?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Yes, yeah. Sir, audible.
So what I'm telling here is that one qubit, you have seen the superposition, but you may not be able to appreciate the benefit. But see here, I'm writing a 3-qubit system. So 3-qubit system can be like this also, where what we are saying is that it is linear combination of 000, 001, 010, and up to 111. So what you are understanding here is that these 3 qubits are there only, but they are representing all 3-bit basis states. That is basically how many basis states will be there with 3 bits? 2 to power 3? So what we are saying is that using only 3 qubits, we are able to represent 2 to power 3 states simultaneously. Okay, yes. If we have small n qubits, then using those small n qubits, you are able to represent 2 to power n states simultaneously. Okay, if you compare it with classical this thing, classical 3 bits, so classical 3 bit system can be in one of these states. That can be, let's suppose it, if it is 001, so bit 1 is 0, bit 2 is 0, and bit 3 is 1. So at a time, this 3-bit classical system can be in one of these states. But here what we are telling is that this system can be in superposition of all possible 2 to power 3 states. Yeah, someone's mic is... Yeah, please mute your mic. So you should be able to appreciate the benefit of having qubits in case in compared to classical bits. Vidyaman, can you mute someone's mic? Yeah. So if there are 3 qubits, then we can have this kind of 2 to power 3 state simultaneously can be represented using this phi 3 system. But what is, okay. So what is the coefficient of this 000 state? So coefficient is 1 by square root 8. So each state has same coefficient. And what is the probability of getting 000 on measurement? Can anyone tell? So probability is nothing but mod square of the amplitude or coefficient. So probability of 000 will be what? Coefficient is 1 by square root 8 and mod square of it. That is what? 1 by 8. So if I ask what is the probability of 110? Can anyone tell? What is the probability of getting 110 on measuring this phi 3? So here again the coefficient is the same.
1 by 8.
So probability will be what? 1 by 8 only? Please reply if you are, let it be interactive and reply. So again the probability will be same. 1 by 8 only. So what we can create this kind of states with 3 qubits using a quantum computer. So if here we are talking about 3 qubits, if we have n qubits, then what will happen? This n qubits can represent 2 to the power n states simultaneously. Okay. So we are having only n qubits, but we are able to represent 2 to the power n states simultaneously, and that is called superposition. Means smaller number of qubits and we are able to cover larger space. So as I told that quantum system can be in superposition, but once you measure it, it becomes classical. So it becomes classical bits. It's given as an output. So suppose this is the quantum system with 3 qubits. Once you measure it, so you can get any of these states with these probabilities. So as I told that if you measure this state, you may get 000 with 1/8 probability. You can get all these equal states are equal probable. So you can get any of these with 1/8 probability. So this is the thing I am telling, that if we have this n qubit system, okay, and if I ask you what is the probability of getting zero state, that will be basically alpha zero mod square. Okay, so think this this n is what is this basically n bit number with all ones. So what I'm telling here is that on measurement you will get one of these output with these probabilities. So probabilities are basically mod alpha I square. Okay, so we will see how it will give you quantum parallelism, but once you measure it, it becomes classical system. So in quantum you may be having all these states simultaneously, but once you measure it, you will get one of them. Is it okay? Any question is there in superposition? Please ask. Please, any question till now? Because it is very basic and you should be clear with that basic. Then only you will be able to understand better other things. Vidya, am I connected or not?
You are connected, sir. You are connected. Some are responding in the chat, sir. Can you able to see the chat, sir?
No. Actually, I made my screen full screen.
Okay.
I request participant to be interactive and just reply. No need to write in the chat box, please.
Yes.
Understood.
Can you explain it again, sir?
Yeah. Which concept? This one.
Superposition. Superposition.
Yeah. So superposition. What we are saying is that if there are n qubits, then we can represent 2 to the power n states simultaneously. Like if you compare with classical, if I say there is n bit number, okay, so what you can write with those n bit numbers? So you can write like this 110 something. This is the n bit number. So let's say you assign all n bits as 1. So you can have one combination. Out of how many combinations possible there with n bit? There are 2 to the power n numbers, basically. Okay, starting from all zeros to
yes,
all ones. Okay,
yes.
Classical, what happens is that if you say that my n bit has been assigned some value, so you can assign one of these 2 to the power n values. Okay,
yes.
Suppose you assign this value, so it will have this value only. But in case of quantum, what we are saying is instead of this n bit, you have n qubits.
Yes.
Then you can have a linear combination. Basically, all this state may present with n qubits. See here.
Okay.
Zero is there, one is there, n minus one is there. So this basically I have written this number as a decimal, but these are binary. So this zero means n times zero. This one means n minus one times zero, and then one. So this is this state. So what we are saying is that all these states are presented by n qubits only.
Okay, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Someone's mic is, yeah, please. So next property is entanglement. So these things, phenomena are not available in classical computing or classical physics. These are quantum phenomena. Okay. So entangled means that superposition we have already understood. So there may be a quantum system which has two parts. Suppose So they these two parts are correlated, means one depend on is dependent on the other. So if you change one system, then other will also be affected. If you have one system as some output, then you will have similar or correlated output into the other system also. So this is a physical quantum mechanical phenomena, but from computing point of view, what it means is, let's suppose there is a state called like this. Let's call it beta 0 0. So if I ask you, this is a state 0 0 plus 1/√2 1 1. So this is qubit 1, qubit 2, qubit 1, qubit 2. Okay, so it's a 2-qubit system with a state like 0 0 plus 1 1/√2. So what I'm saying is that these 2 qubits are entangled, means they are correlated. Okay, so what it means is that so if I ask you with this system, so superposition, we understood it is superposition of both 0 0 and 1 1 state. So there is no state like this 0 times 0 1 plus 0 times 1 0. So this 0 1 and 1 0 are missing here. So we can have this kind of superposition. That is fairly okay. We can create also this kind of a state. So what I want to tell you here is that this is a 2-qubit system, and if you measure this 2-qubit system, then what is the probability that you get 0 0 state? Can anyone tell? What is the probability?
1/2, sir.
Perfect. What's your name?
Atisha.
Atisha, thank you. So just simply mod square this coefficient, then you will get the probability. Okay. Now if I ask you, what is the probability of measuring 1 1?
1/2.
Perfect. And suppose if I ask you, what is the probability of measuring first qubit as 0? I want to measure this 2-qubit system is there, but just I am measuring the first qubit, and I am asking you, what is the probability of measuring first qubit as 0? Can anyone? So here there is no 0 qubit. First qubit is 0 here only, na? So in that case, you will get this first qubit as 0. So measuring first qubit q1 as 0, probability is again 1/2.
1/2.
But let's suppose first qubit is 0, then what is the probability of second qubit being 0? So in that case, this case is gone, because either this state can be measured in 0 0 or 1 1. So if first qubit is 0, it means this state prevailed, or this is being measured. So second qubit will definitely be 0. Are you getting this point? First qubit probability is there. This can be 0 also, can be 1 also. But once you measure the first qubit as 0, then second qubit has no choice. It must be 0 only. Is it okay or not? So let's see again. What is the probability of first qubit 1?
1/2, sir.
1/2. So it means you have collapsed to this state. Are you getting this thing? Once you measure this qubit 1 with 50% probability, then first qubit is 1. So it means second qubit will be what? Second qubit is definitely 1. So first qubit, if you measure 1, then it is explicit that second qubit will be 1 only. So this qubit can be entangled like this, can be created like this. And understand this qubit as, like, suppose these qubits are photon. Okay, so what I'm saying here is this q1 and q2 are basically photon, and their entangled state is created like this. Suppose now I take this photon q2 on another planet. Okay, so now this q1 and q2 are far away. Okay, but if someone measure this q1, okay, so measuring Q1 getting 0 and 1 is 50-50. So suppose if on Earth Q1 is there and it measured 0, then at the same moment or simultaneously on the another planet Q2 will be also collapsing to 0. If Q1 collapses to 1, the same moment this Q2 will collapse to 1. So measuring first output is random, but once one is measured, the other is trivially known. So are you seeing this benefit here? Getting Q1 0 or 1 is 50-50, but once you know about one of the qubit, then you know about the other system also. That other system will be also same as mine. And this thing happen instantaneously. So this thing is very useful and have variety of application in cryptography and quantum teleportation, we will see. But timing, you need to understand that these two qubits, when they are entangled, means they are correlated. If one of the qubit is zero, then other will be zero. If one of the qubit is one, then other will be one. So timing, you need to understand what entangled means. These qubits are in superposition in such a way that they are correlated and their correlation is perfect. Like one is zero, then other will be zero. Okay. And this has variety of application. So we can create this kind of well state. So this kind of state, if you want to create, then you initialize two qubits with 0, 0, then apply this gate SETA mode and control node gate, then you will get this kind of state. So this kind of Bell states can be created. Okay. And here is a snapshot taken from IBM Quantum Composer, where you can create this kind of circuits. So initialize the two qubits with 0, 0, and then apply HADAM and then apply C node. So you will get this kind of state. Okay. So once you measure this, so here what you will be getting, you will be getting that beta 0, 0 state, or you call Bell state. And this Bell state is basically an example of entangled state. So as I told already that probability of getting 0, 0 is 50%. Sorry, here it is amplitude. So it is basically 1 by square root of 2. That is basically 0.707. So this is amplitude, or we can say coefficient of the state. And here it is the probability. So probability will be mod square. So see here, probability is 50-50 of getting 0, 0 and 1, 1 on measurement. Okay. Now, as we have, we know about these two phenomena, superposition and entanglement. So now we will be able to understand how this quantum parallelism works. So can anyone explain this first diagram, normal computer? If I want to compute some function f on 4-bit values, okay? So some f function I want to implement 4 bits, x1, x2, x3, and x4. Let's call it like this, y is equal to f of. So this function take 4 bits, x1, x2, x3, x4, and I want to compute its value y. So classical, what happens? Can anyone explain this first diagram? Please don't write in the chat box, reply if you know.
Function of x1, x2 dash, x3, x4.
Yes. So some function f is there. Function, what is the function doing? We are not concerned about that. But in case of classical, suppose I want to compute it for all possible 4-bit values. So how many 4-bit values will be there? If I draw the truth table, x1, x2, x3, x4, and compute y here. Can anyone tell how many entries will be there?
16.
So if I want to compute this f on classical computer, then what I can do? I need to supply the value one by one. So 16 values will be there. So here our small n I can say is 4, number of variables, and the states will be how much?
2 power 4, sir.
2 power n, that is basically 4. So here it is 16. So I have to run this app how many times?
16 number of times.
16 time I need to compute this function. Okay. But in quantum, what we are saying is, using 4 qubits, what we can do? Using 4 qubits, as I already told, 4 qubit system is there. 4 qubit system, let's call it 5-4. Then it can be like this. Some coefficient, I can call it as alpha 0. 0 0 0, alpha 0 0 0 1 up to alpha 1 1 1. So what we are saying is that using 4 qubits, we can have a state like this, which is superposition of all possible 4 bit values, starting from all zeros to all ones. And these are basically coefficient of these states. So this alpha i's are basically the coefficient or amplitude of these states. And what is the condition there? That sum of this alpha I mod square should be what? 1. Probability of 0, 0, 0 on measurement is what? Alpha 0, 0 mod square?
1 by 2 power 4.
1 by 2 power 4. So it can be, condition is that the mod square of this coefficient and sum should be 1. So it can be 1 by 4 also. So it can be 1 by 4 in that case. All are having same coefficient, 1 by 4. So if you square it, then it will be, probability will be what? 1 by 16 of each state. So don't worry about this coefficient. Just focus here that this 5-4 has all this state with it, only using 4 qubits. Now if I ask you, if I apply this function f on this 4 qubit, so what will happen is that this f will be applied on all these 4 bit values instantaneously or simultaneously. Here in classical, what was happening? We are computing this f one by one for different values of x1, x2, x3, x4. But in case of quantum, we can represent all the 16 states simultaneously. And when we apply this function f on this 4 qubit system, so in turn, this f is being calculated on all possible values possible with 4 bit. So this thing is called quantum parallelism. Are you getting this thing? Participant, please reply in yes, or if you are
yes,
not
sir.
Able to.
Yes, sir.
So are you able to see the benefit here? The thing yes. Which was taking 16 time you have to run this app, here in one execution, you are able to compute it for all possible 4 bit values. Okay, and here only we are showing it for 4 qubits, but if you generalize it for n qubits, then you will be able to appreciate the benefit. So let's suppose this n is 100, okay, then what will happen? N is 100, then the how many states will be possible? 2 to power 100. How many, like in this table, we are seeing that only 16 entries are there. If it was n is equal to 100, then there will be 2 to power 100 entries, okay? And if you do it classically, then it will take millions of years. But on a quantum computer, you can have 100 qubit system here in case of 4, okay, and you can apply, you can have superposition of this 2 to power 100 states simultaneously. So these many states will be there, and when you apply the f, it will be applied on all possible 2 to power 100 states simultaneously. Okay, so are you getting this thing, the quantum parallelism phenomena?
Yes, sir.
But there is a catch. Like you can compute all this. The thing is the okay. So let's be here only. So if I ask you, I have computed this F. So I got this computation and it is inside a quantum mechanical system or quantum computer. But once we measure this system, so what we will be getting? So we will get either this or this or this. We cannot have all these as an answer. What we will be having is we will having one of these as an output on measurement. And what is the probability of measuring this thing? F of 001 will be basically mod alpha 0001 square. Are you able to see that thing? So on measurement, we will not be able to see the result of all this fx. We will have them with certain probabilities. And those probabilities is what? Those probabilities are basically the coefficient mod square. So and here if you see, if these probabilities are same, this mod alpha I square is same, then you will not able to distinguish your answer. So the catch here is that we can compute them in quantum system, it is there, but on measurement we will not get all of them. On measurement we will get one of them with certain probabilities, with associated properties, probabilities. So in quantum algorithms we do some clever techniques, okay, we do some clever techniques to get the desired answer. Let's suppose this F of 001 is our desired answer out of all these. Then in the quantum algorithm what is done is that we try to improve the probability of this its coefficient and decrease the others. So in quantum algorithm, whatever your answer will be there, you try to increase its amplitude and probabilities and decrease the others. Okay, so if you improve the probability of this 0001 state, then automatically others will be decreased because this probability sum should be one. So if let's suppose my probability of this alpha 001 is become 90%, then other state will become 10%. The other state's probability sum will be 10%. So the thing here is to understand that you can do the parallel processing using quantum parallelism, but on measurement you will not get all the answers. So to distinguish your answer from known answers, you have to do some clever techniques in quantum algorithm to get your answer with higher probability. Okay, so this thing will be discussed in a separate session on quantum algorithms, but the overall idea is that we create the superposition and we use this quantum parallelism and some clever techniques to implement our algorithms, and they give advantage over classical algorithms or classical computers. So is there any doubt in quantum parallelism, participants?
No, sir.
Okay. Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah, please, what's your name?
Jayalakshmi.
Jayalakshmi, please.
Since till measurement, all these probability of occurrence of all the states are unknown. Is it so, sir? If we measure, it may condense it to one state.
Yes. So with certain probabilities, a certain state will appear. So you need to run the experiment several times to get the proper probability distribution.
The so probability quantum, can also vary with respect to the.
Yes. So in the initial, what we do is we create equal superposition. So like this, if you see here, here we created this state, let's suppose. Here you see the probability is same for all these states. 1/8 only. Okay, so what we do is initially we create this kind of states and we call them as equal superposition state. Then we do our F, Our f is our basically some quantum algorithm or function we want to implement. So on implementation of this f, this probability will changes. And in the quantum algorithm, we do some clever tricks so that we get our answer with higher probability. If you see here, probability is same. So you cannot distinguish answer. Let's suppose my answer is 001 of some problem. Then getting 001 is 1/8. Getting 00 is 1/8. So I cannot distinguish my answer with non-answer. So in the quantum algorithm implementation, we or the algorithm try to increase the probability of this state, whichever is the answer, okay, and decrease others. So in general, what happens is that if it is more than 50 or 60-70%, then we will say, okay, this is our answer, because others will be having less probability. So probabilities in initial superposition are same, but during the implementation of our quantum algorithm, it changes and increases for our desired answer and decreases for not desired answer. Jayalakshmi, I answered your question, or any clarity is required?
Initially, the probability will be the same. By using the algorithm, we have to fix up the probability of occurrence for the output we expect. So if it is having more number of percentage, then that is taken as a correct probability.
Perfect. So like in case of classical, we have some classical gates, AND gate, OR gate, NAND gate. So here also we have quantum operators or quantum gates, we can call them, and we can represent them as a unitary matrix. And there is some property of this unitary matrices that U inverse is U star, or basically U dagger we call it. So you can understand it like this: U dagger is identity. Means for a U, suppose U is a some quantum gate operator, and then there exists a U inverse that is basically U star. So for every quantum gate or quantum operator, there exists an inverse gate operation which will nullify the operation of the gate. Okay, so if I apply U gate on this phi state, then it will become phi dash. Suppose I have this U inverse, that is U star. So if I apply U inverse on this, or U star you can call it, then I will get the original state. So quantum gates are reversible. Okay, so this is key difference with classical gates. So if you remember classical AND gate, AND gate, you remember anyone? AND gate. Anyone?
0001.
So in case of 1-1, it is 1-1. So yeah. So if I have these two input, can be denoted like this. X1, X2, and here you get X1 and X2. So can you go from this output to inputs in reverse direction? So the forward direction is okay. So if you apply some two inputs bit, and then you will get the AND of X1 and X2. So can you go in reverse direction uniquely? Suppose I am given output X1, X2 as 0. Can you tell about X1 and X2? Anyone? So in case of, sorry,
X1 and X2 can be either 00 or 01 or 10.
Yes, so you cannot tell what was the initial state X1 and X2 uniquely. So means the classical gates are not invertible like this AND gate. So in classical, only the NOT gate is invertible. So NOT gate, you know, NOT gate simply X is there, then it become X prime. So you apply NOT gate again, then you will get original X. So in case of, let's suppose it was 1-0. So seeing the output, you can tell about the input. So let's suppose after NOT gate, I get as 0 as an output. So I can tell it must be 1. If I get 1 here, then I can tell the input was 0. So you can go in reverse direction uniquely. So other than this NOT gate, there is no other gate which is reversible in classical. But in quantum, all quantum gates are reversible, means there exists an inverse gate for a gate. So this is a gate matrix, and this will be covered in further sessions. But the thing here to understand is that there is a gate called Toffoli gate. Okay, so using this Toffoli gate, you can create AND gate, NOT gate. So if I can create using this Toffoli, I can construct AND and NOT gate. So I can construct NAND gate. And NAND is what? Universal gate. Anyone remember this thing? Universal gate. Guys, so what I'm saying is, in quantum gate there are several gates to understand, but the important gate is called the Toffoli gate. And using this Toffoli, you can construct AND and NOT gate. And if you have AND and NOT, then you can have this NAND gate. So basically, it's a universal gate. So whatever classical Boolean logic you want to implement, you can implement using this NAND gate. So whatever thing you want to do in classical can be done using this Toffoli gate only. And these other things are not having their equivalent in classical. So basically, these things are extra in quantum. So will be explained in the session in quantum gates. But try to understand that whatever you want to do in classical can be done using this Toffoli here. But here are several things extra which can be done using quantum gates. So once you have these qubits and quantum gates, then you can construct a quantum circuit. So basically, if you want to implement some quantum algorithm, then you have to construct equivalent quantum circuit. So if you see in the quantum circuit, what happens is that there are some qubits which are initialized or with set with some states. So this Q1 and Q2 are initialized with 0, 0, and it is initialized with some state psi. Then what happens? Qubits are there. So these wires representing qubits. Okay. And these are quantum gates. Okay. So the gate will be covered in a later session, but try to understand that qubits are there and some gates are applied from left to right. Okay. So, and then you do some measurement. So because this thing is quantum. Okay. But once you measure those qubits, you will get some classical outputs. And in the quantum algorithm, what we want, whenever we measure this thing, we should get the answer with high probability on measurement here. Okay. And these registers are classical, basically classical bits. So we call them as Z or X, maybe you can rename them anything. And if you want to apply some operation on this Q2, see here Q2, I want to apply this quantum gates, conditional quantum gate X and Z, depending upon the value of this and this bits. So that can be also done. So what we are doing is, depending upon the value of this and this bits, we will be applying this X and Z gate on the third qubit. So we already measured these two qubits. We got the output of this two qubits in classical, and can conditionally apply quantum gates on other Q2 qubit. So what we are saying is that this quantum circuits, basically for every quantum algorithm or quantum program, it will be boiled down to this kind of quantum circuits, where physically these qubits will be there and these quantum gates will be applied on those qubits. Similar to our classical computing also happens this. Everything, whatever program in C or C++ you write, it will be finally boiled down to assembly instructions, and those are executed on the processor. So similar kind of thing is here. So there are few differences between classical and quantum circuits. So as you are aware about this, you can say that, okay, in classical and quantum computing also this kind of differences are there. So classical are based on classical physics. Here it is based on quantum mechanics. So what this quantum mechanics gives? Superposition, entanglement, and other phenomena. Here we have qubits, which are more powerful than this classical bits. Here we have quantum gates, which are applied on these qubits. And these quantum gates are what? They are reversible. Similar to classical gates, we have also universal quantum gates. These are reversible. And there is already this kind of technology, CMOS IC technology is there. So here also we have different technologies to implement these qubits and quantum gates. So One of the important or popular technique is superconducting technologies. So just to understand that what is the difference in classical and quantum circuits, so these are the key differences. So if you go about quantum computing architecture, then it will look like this. So there will be two kinds of layer. One is physical layer and one is logical layer. So top you can see, this is the logical layer where your quantum algorithms will be there, or quantum programs which you write or implement. And those will be converted into quantum instructions, and that will go to here, this quantum logical processor. Means what are the equivalent instruction will be there in quantum. So, and then we will be on the physical layer, we will be having some quantum error correction component, and whatever this quantum instruction or this program you have, those will be converted into microwave pulses. Basically you can say them as a quantum gates. So using these microwave pulses with particular frequencies on qubits, we can implement quantum gates. Okay. And there will be underlying quantum processor will be having qubits. Okay. On those qubits, we will be applying this quantum gates, and then we will be measuring. So on measurement, we will read out the things, and if there is some errors, then that will be rectified using this quantum error correction thing, and then you will get the answer. So both the things are equally important, because you should have quantum algorithms which gives the speed. Okay, so one thing to remember here is that quantum computers are give a speed up for certain problems. It's not like that for every problem quantum computer is giving speed up, because to get the speed up, you should have a clever quantum algorithm which exploit this quantum parallelism phenomena. So there are a limited number of quantum algorithms which give speed up, namely Shor's, Grover's and other things. So for certain problems, there are efficient quantum algorithm which are giving speed up. Others, we don't have efficient quantum algorithms. So this is IBM Melbourne quantum computer, which has this 15 qubits. Okay, this is the topology of this quantum computer, where how these qubits are interconnected. So, and what are the errors? So there may be single qubit gates are there, and control node gate error rates. So so this device is calibrated, and error values of this is given. Okay, and what kind of basis gate it supports. Okay, so basis gate means it's on universal set of quantum gates. So whatever quantum algorithm you will give to this quantum computer, it will break down those quantum instruction into its basis set gate. Okay, so these things shows the quantum volume we will see. But the thing here is to understand that this qubits are interconnected in this fashion. And if you see, if I want to apply some operation between qubit 0 and qubit 7, that I cannot do directly. For that, I have to do some swap operations. Okay, then only I will be able to do it. So it is because this graph is not completely connected. Okay, the connection is not completely connected. So qubits 0 and 7 are far away. So using swap gate operation, we can do it. So these are the significant quantum algorithms which give the momentum for quantum computer development. So let's start with this 1982. In 1982, Richard Feynman, scientist, gave that idea that if you want to simulate a quantum system, then you should simulate it on a quantum mechanical device, not on a classical computer. If you do it on a classical computer, it will be inefficient, and for larger system, it will not be possible. So if you want to simulate quantum system, then go for quantum mechanical device. So in that 1982, Feynman called it a quantum mechanical device, and that is nothing but a quantum computer he was talking about. So in 82, Richard Feynman gave idea that if you want to simulate some quantum system or quantum phenomena efficiently, then quantum computer is the thing we should go for, not the classical computers. Because after a certain stage, this classical computers has their limitation. If you see the classical best super computer, then it will be having 300 petaflop capacity. If you want to go for more power, then you will not go. So we'll see. But this idea was given in 1982 by Richard Feynman, and that's why he is called father of quantum computing. So 1982 he gave the idea. In 1992, Doss and Josa gave a quantum algorithm which gave exponential speed up over classical algorithms. So we are talking about this quantum algorithm here. Focus that we are talking about the quantum algorithm. Maybe that time they don't have a quantum computer with them, but they are able to design efficient quantum algorithms. If you run those algorithms on quantum computer, then this Doss-Josa algorithm can give a speed up of exponential compared to the classical one. Exponential, you understand? Polynomial, if I say, then it is some kind of like n cube or something. Order of n cube is recalled as a polynomial. And if it is like e power n or some 2 power n or something. So here, let's suppose it is n cube, then if it is taking n cube time, then it is taking, it is doing the exponentially time faster, means. So let's suppose something in classical is taking 2 to power n, classical. Then in quantum, it can do in polynomial time or order 1 time. So in case of this Doss-Josa algorithm, deciding that function is constant or balanced, for n bit function, it was 2 to power n complexity, but it was done in order 1. So basically, the speed up of exponential speed up was given by this Doss-Josa algorithm for a classical problem. So this was the first algorithm, but this deciding that whether function is balanced or constant was not a very practical algorithm which has wide variety of applications. So deciding that function is constant or not is not a big deal or not have a wide application. But in 1994, Peter Shor gave a quantum algorithm for factorization. So in that, so we will be seeing this algorithm more detail, but to understand this thing that this factorization problem is very hard, and classically we can do it in sub exponential time. So, but in Peter-Shor algorithm, we can do it in polynomial time. We will see. And this algorithm has variety of application in cryptography and other domains. So here this speed up gives us breakthrough. Using this algorithm on a quantum computer, we can break RSA or other kind of public key crypto systems. So this algorithm in 1994 created interest in academia, industry, and others to develop a quantum computer. Because if you have a quantum computer with you and this source algorithm, then you can break this kind of public key ciphers. So after 94, because in 1982 the idea was given about quantum computer, but till 1994 there was no quantum computer designed or developed. After this Peter Shor's algorithm, interest from academia and industry, and then quantum computer development started. That we will see. But after 90 Peter Shor's algorithm, true development in quantum computer implementation and design started. Another algorithm, Grover search, was there. So in that search, we will see in detail, but it is basically giving quadratic speed up. Here exponential, here exponential, here quadratic speed up, general search. Okay. In 1996, this Lord also proposed this quantum simulation algorithm, where it was saying that if using few qubits and few steps, we can simulate a quantum system which will take these many numbers. Avogadro numbers means 6 × 10²³ memory sites. Basically, this many is memory you require on a classical computer, or this order of instruction you require. But in case of quantum, if you do that thing on quantum, then you can do in few tens of qubits. So these quantum computers are very suitable for simulating quantum systems or systems at atomic level. So one application will be like this, that this is a caffeine module molecule which has this CH3 and nitrogen carbon, and this kind of structure is there. So it's a very small, if you see, then only 10 or 20 this atoms are there inside it. So if I ask you how this caffeine molecule impact our brain, so it gives us boost up. If you take coffee, then it gives you boost up. So if I ask you how this caffeine molecule impact our brains, if I ask you to simulate it on a classical computer, then it is not feasible even on a best supercomputer available today with precision. So, but if you have a quantum computer with hundreds of qubits, then you can do it. You can do it exactly. Okay. So this is the you can say key application of quantum computers, or can have speed up over classical computers. So the thing to simulate this kind of simulation of a molecule or an impact of it on brain is not feasible on classical supercomputer, but can be done with precision on a quantum computer with hundreds of qubits. So these are some of the strategic applications of quantum algorithms and computer. Factoring is one of them. And wherever you want to do some optimization or some simulation or some classification. So here, if you see, if you want to do some searching kind of thing, so searching is very important problem, and this Grover's algorithm make it fast for you. Wherever optimization you want to do, so you can do optimization fast on quantum devices. Let's in data analysis also, you want to do some kind of machine learning classification on a large database, then you can do it efficiently using quantum computer. So wherever this kind of thing like simulation, optimization, or searching is there, or factoring is there, in all those domains this quantum computer gives speed up. Okay, so till now we have talked about how this quantum computer gives speed up, what are the underlying theories are there. If you want to do quantum programming, then how we can do it? So if you go to the IBM quantum computing website, then you will be able to log into this kind of page over there. So you will be having this option, IBM Quantum Composer. So what Composer means is that you can compose your circuit or quantum circuit using the gates. So these kind of gates are available. Okay, these quantum gates are there, qubits are there. So this is qubits 1, 0, qubits 1. So you can add qubits here, and you can drag and drop this kind of gates on this circuit. Okay, let's suppose this is there. So what I'm telling here is that if you want to do quantum programming using a graphical interface, so basically it's a GU kind of thing, where simply you can drag and drop these quantum gates over here, and you can construct the quantum circuit, and you can run it. So on the run, you will be having option on which quantum computer you want to run, so you can run it. Okay, and on running, you will be getting answer like this. On measurement, you will be getting this kind of probability. Okay, so on measurement, you will be getting 0011 kind of state at 100% probability. So the thing here is to understand is that if you want to do quantum programming, then you can log in into that website or a cloud, and you can create a quantum circuit. So whatever circuit you are designing here, you will be having corresponding quantum assembly code. Quantum assembly code. So this kind of quantum assembly code you will be having. Okay, so whatever changes you do here in the quantum assembly, let's suppose I apply some gate here, I write the instruction to apply some gate here, then automatically the circuit will be updated. If I do some changes in the circuit, then the quantum assembly code will also be updated. So simple, and for beginners, you can go on this website and can create the quantum circuit and can test on different platforms. Okay, and also have this quantum assembly code with you. It's for beginner, it's good, but for professional and for large quantum applications, other way is there, and that is called Qiskit. So basically, it is quantum information software kit. And what it does is, and what it provides you is, it's basically open source SDK. So using this SDK, you can program various quantum computers at different levels. Levels means pulses, basically quantum gates, circuits, or application level. So whatever level you want to program quantum computers, you can do it. Means gate level also, or the higher level also. And Qiskit basically accelerate your development, because whatever, let's suppose in the development you require the source algorithm. So already source algorithm has been implemented. So as a function call kind of thing, you can do here in your quantum application, wherever you require. So Qiskit gives you a faster development option of your quantum application, because there are lots of things available in Qiskit. You can use them to speed up your quantum application development. See here, what are the things you can do with Qiskit? So for quantum programming with Qiskit, so you can design your application, you can implement some quantum algorithm, you can characterize the quantum device also. Characterize means what are the different kinds of noises in the quantum device, so you can calibrate them, okay? And even you can mitigate them. You can construct circuit also, like in the case of Composer you see, and you can create some extension for others' uses, and you can write quantum code for this kind of thing. But you can run this thing on simulator as well as quantum hardware. So hardware means quantum computer basically. Simulators are basically classical computers only, but there you can see how quantum computer will behave on your quantum circuit. So these are basically classical computers which are trying to simulate the behavior of quantum computers. Because these devices are precious, quantum computers are precious, there is long waiting queue, because IBM or some other companies has available smaller quantum devices available to general public, wherein you can run your small quantum circuits, but there is some waiting queue. So if you want to test your circuit, then you can do it on simulator, because simulators is basically classical computer only. So you can test your codes first on simulator, then if everything is okay, then you can run it on actual hardware. So this is Qiskit structure, wherein this Terra is the module which is interfacing this Qiskit with the underlying hardware. So hardware is what? Our simulator and quantum computers. Aqua component is for quantum algorithms. So there are different quantum algorithms from variety of domains, like suppose machine learning or source algorithm or any different, whatever the algorithms existing are there, are already been implemented and available to you. Those you can use in your application directly. So you need not to write code for existing quantum algorithms. You can directly use them in your implementation. AIR is for simulator kind of thing. And IGNIS is for error characterization. Means these devices have some errors. So you can characterize those errors and you can mitigate those errors also using this IGNIS module. So I think we have half an hour more. Vidya ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Half an hour more. So I think.
Yes, sir. It is up to 11:30, sir.
Okay. So 5-10 minutes over is okay?
Or... it is okay, sir. No issues.
Okay. So participant, just now we have seen that there is this Qiskit and this IBM Composer kind of thing, wherein you can program quantum computers. So just a second. So if you search this IBM Quantum Experience, then you will be having this kind of links. So if you click on them, then it will ask you for email. Then once you log in into those devices, then you can go over this Composer. So these kind of circuits you have, okay? So let's suppose this is the circuit. So I want to show you this option. Okay. So here, once you click on this setup and run thing, so you will be having these options here. Okay. Quasar simulator is there. There is a computer, IBM quantum computer called IBM Q Manila, and it is having 5 qubits, IBM Q Bogota. So these are device Santiago. So these devices are available and it is online. There are total 39 jobs, 40 jobs pending. So you can see the detail also about this devices. So see here, these 5 qubits are this kind of linearly connected. Okay. And about their different parameters like CNOT error, readout error. So these kind of parameters are given. What are the gates available? So whatever quantum gate you use in your circuit, it will convert them into its basis set of quantum gates. This is the set here. So you can choose a simulator and quantum devices of your choice, which is available to you. Although this IBM has a more number of qubit devices, but those are not available to general public. Okay. So premium access is there to high-end devices. Here I wanted to tell that if I do some changes in the quantum assembly code here, suppose if I apply X gate on qubit 1, so automatically this X gate will come here. Are you getting this thing? If I remove this instruction, then that gate will be removed from here. See here, it has been removed. So you can just simply drag and drop this kind of gate here. Okay. Then you can run also. So I think you can, if you are new to this field, then you can begin with this composer kind of thing and you can learn. Once you learn this thing, then you can install Qiskit and do the other things. So let's get back to the slide again. So just now I told that how you can start your quantum programming thing. So I will be discussing two quantum algorithms, which are very important and which has a variety of applications. First one of them is Grover search. So Love Grover is an Indian who designed this algorithm in 1996. So what was the idea is that if there are there n data items and which are not sorted, then if you want to perform classical search, then the complexity will be what? Order of n. Okay. Can you do faster on unsorted data in classical? Anyone? Suppose data is sorted, then can you do searching fast? Anyone?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. What kind of searching algorithm you can apply?
Binary search.
Perfect. So if data is sorted, then it's okay. We can apply sorted, then binary search. So binary search complexity is what? Log n. Perfect.
Oh.
Okay. Suppose data is not sorted, then if you want to apply this binary search, then what is the condition? You need to sort them. Sorting algorithm you apply. So there are different sorting algorithm. Can you name anyone? The best one?
Quicksort.
Yeah. So what is the complexity? That is basically n. log n. So if data is unsorted and you sort them, then you will take this much effort, n log n. Okay. And then you can do it in log n using binary search. But yes, this is a huge effort. N log n is huge effort. What this Grover is claiming here is that given a quantum computer, he can do searching on unsorted data in how much time? Square root of n time. So compared to this n, it is quadratic speed up, and this speed up is so much. You may not be feeling here in the difference, but if you search database of our Aadhaar card, so how many entries will be there? Around 1.3 into 10 raised to power 10. Aadhaar database. And if we want to search, if you do it classically, then it will require this many effort, 10 to power 10. But if you apply this quantum Grover search, then it will be square root of it. So that will be what? 10 raised to the power 5, something 1.1 or something. Okay. So Grover's, using Grover, it will be this much. 10 to the power 5 is nothing but 10,000 only. So it is around 11,500 or so. So these many efforts is required, 11,000 only. And here, if you see in classical, it will be 10 to the power 10. That is so much. So this quadratic speed up is also very significant. Okay. Here you are searching 1 million or 1.3 million. And here you are searching only 10 to the power 5 only. This is the speed up you are getting. So the key point here is to learn is that it gives us quadratic speed up on unsorted data. Unsorted, best you can do is order n. Quantum can do it in square root of n. So n is the size or the data size basically, or the space you want to search. So here, if I ask you some quantum algorithm or symmetric key cryptography, so if there is an algorithm called AES, which has key size of 128 bits, then how many keys are possible with this 128 bits? Can anyone tell? Possible keys with 128 bits?
2 to the power 128.
2 power 128.
What will be the choice? What will be the option, choices? It will be like this: 000, 128 time up to, sorry, this will be the set. Is it okay? Means 128 bits are there, so it can be all zeros one time, then one. So it will be like 2 to the power 1 entries will be there. Okay. So this kind of AES 128 bit key encryption is used, and it requires 2 to the power 128 total keys. So suppose I am using one of those keys. Let's suppose my one of the key K is there, and with the value is like this. Okay, some random key is there. So I'm using it for encryption. If I ask you to exhaustively try all possible keys and find out which key I used. Okay, so exhaustive trial for you is quite, will take tremendous time. It may be take me millions of years, because 2 to the power 128 keys you need to try in order to find out my key K which I used. So this space is very large. If you want to do brute force or exhaustive trial, sorry. So these many keys you cannot try. So in classical scenario, if you want to do this many trial, then it will take millions of years. So you are secure. But in case of quantum computer, and if you have this Grover search, then this space can be reduced to how much? Square root of 2 to the power 128. Can anyone tell how much is this? 2 to the power? Square root of 2 to the power 128? Participants? I'm asking you, what is the value of square root of 2 to the power 128?
It is 2 to the power of 64.
64, perfect. What's your name?
Anand.
Anand, thank you. So basically, if you compare this 2 to the power 128 and 2 to the power 64, then this 2 to the power 64 is way less or very small compared to this 2 to the power 128. So this kind of brute force can be done. 2 to the power 64 can be done with current supercomputers. So what I'm saying here is that if you have a Grover search or a quantum computer for this kind of symmetric key cryptography like AES, if the key size is suppose 128, then you can convert that problem into root power 64, and then you can do it on classical. So there is a threat for AES. If we have a large universal quantum computer, then we can reduce it to this and we can do it, and we can find this key used. Okay, so what they say is that if key is k bit, so then how many keys will be there? 2 to the power k, and classical Grover's, if you apply, then it will be 2 to the power k by 2. So it will be reduced to this much. So the general recommendation to overcome Grover attack is that you just double the key size. So currently we believe that 128 bit is secure, but quantum will make it 2 to the power 64. So just double the key size. So instead of 128, if we use 256, then Grover will also reduce it to how much? It will be 2 to the power 128. On Grover also, it will be 2 to the power 128, and brute force of 2 to the power 128 on classical is infeasible. It will take millions of years. So the general recommendation for symmetric cryptography is that Grover's can speed up the exhaustive trial. So you will just double the key size of your current standard. Then you will be safe against Grover search. Okay. And this Grover search is have variety of applications, like in minimum spanning tree, or you can say traveling salesman problem. So wherever you have a large space and you want to search best solution, then you can apply this Grover search. Okay. So one of the most important quantum algorithm is called Shor's algorithm, and what it does is, given this number n, okay, what is this n? The pundits call it this number n, and it is multiplication of some number, prime number p and q. So given this n, I ask you to find p and q. It is nothing but pq only. So if I ask you to multiply this p and q, you can do it in polynomial time, okay? But if I ask you the reverse question, if I give you the multiplication n, and if I ask you to find p and q, so will that be hard or easy? For large number, it's a hard problem, and the best you can do it is, sorry?
It's hard in classical computation, sir.
Yes. So to represent this capital N number, you require log n bits. So the complexity is exponential. Log n means number of bits. So it is sub exponential. Classical best algorithm will take. So algorithm name is general number field sieve algorithm. So classically, if you want to do, and it is sub exponential. But if you have a quantum algorithm and the Shor's algorithm, then you can do it in polynomial time. N is what? The number of bits. Okay. So what we are saying here is that this factoring large integer is hard problem for classical. The best algorithm is also sub exponential. So for this kind of large number, it will take millions of years. But for Shor's, the complexity is on polynomial and can be done in minutes on a quantum computer. Okay. So see here. So what is happening there is that, so the idea here is to understand that this Shor's algorithm, what it does is it converts the problem of factorization into period finding. And this period finding can be solved using quantum Fourier transformation. So basically, factorization is converted into period finding, and period is efficiently found using quantum Fourier transformation in Shor's algorithm. So the comparison here is shown that if you have a quantum computer, large enough quantum computer, and if you want to factor this kind of 300 digit number, then the best classical algorithm is general number field sieve will take 10 to power 24 steps. Here Shor's algorithm only 10 to power 10 steps. And if we have a classical computer with terahertz computing power, then it will take 150,000 years. Okay, 1 terahertz quantum classical computer you have, and if you have a 1 terahertz quantum computer, then it will do it in 1 second. So see the difference here. The same thing we kept. The steps are more in classical because Shor's is an efficient algorithm, polynomial time. Here it was exponential, and same kind of computing power in classical and quantum. Then it can be done in only 1 second. Here it is taking 150,000 years. So see the speed up or advantage of a quantum computer using this Shor's algorithm. The thing which was not possible in classical can be done in seconds on a quantum device. But here the challenge is that to run this Shor's algorithm, we require a quantum computer which has around 4,000 qubits. So currently we don't have a 4,000 qubit device. Okay. So once we have those kind of devices, then we can do this kind of things. But for future, we will be having this kind of quantum devices. Then it is a threat for RSA kind of crypto systems. Here also, we are just telling the speed up which we will get. So what we are telling here is in the quantum computer's effect on current cryptographic system. So this RSA or ECC kind of public system will not be safe because we have polynomial time algorithms. In case of AES and AES algorithms or symmetric algorithm, the key size will be reduced to half basically. So if you double the key size, then you will be safe. Here, Dose Josa told about, do we need to worry now? Because this, we don't have a large quantum computer today. So effect on crypto, we have told that this RSA and ECC are not secured in case of a quantum computer we have. So it tells that three things you need to consider, X, Y, and Z. So Z is the collapse time, basically in how much time we are going to have a quantum computer. Okay, so let's suppose that is 10 years time, we are having a large quantum computer with us. Then if I'm using some crypto which has shelf life of X year, and migration time means if you want to go from current crypto to another crypto system, then you will take migration time, that is Y years. So let's suppose our Z is 10 years. In 10 years time, I am going to have a quantum computer. If I want to secure my information for 10 years, and if I take migration time 2 years, and what will happen? My X plus Y is 12 year and Z is only 10. So whenever my X plus Y is more than Z, or basically the quantum computer I will be having, then I need to worry. Okay. Because I need to worry. Why worry? Because what people are doing now is that they are having a large data centers. Okay. And in data center, what they are doing is that whatever online or some transactions we do, we use this kind of RSA, ECC kind of algorithms in for encrypting. So countries are intercepting the data from internet and storing them on a huge data centers. And what they will be doing is, once they will have a large quantum computer, then they will decrypt those kind of traffic which are their national interest. Okay. So the thing is that we should worry, because if we are using some RSA or other kind of system which are not secure in advent of quantum computer, and we are using them, maybe after several years or few years, people can decrypt them. So if you want to secure for longer duration, then there are other things which we call quantum safe cryptography. Means RSA, ECC and other things are not secure. So we should have quantum safe crypto. And what is the idea here is that we want to be safe in case of a large scale quantum computer. So there are two things which we can do. We can have conventional crypto systems with quantum resistance algorithms. Okay. And other thing is that we can use quantum cryptography. So I will tell what is these two things. So this quantum safe is consist of two things. One is called post-quantum cryptography, or we call it that a quantum resistant. Means, so these are the systems. These are PQC systems, multivariate based lattice. So idea here is to understand is that if we have a system based on lattice, or the underlying hard problem is from lattice, that can be shortest vector problem or any other problem from lattice, if we use for designing our crypto system, then we will be safe, because currently we do not have a efficient quantum algorithm to break this kind of lattice based systems or multivariate based system. So what we are saying is that this factorization, discrete log is there another. So in the system RSA or ECC, so DLP, so this kind of factorization, discrete log or ECC kind of problems are used in current public key ciphers. So for them, this source algorithm was efficient to break this factorization or discrete log or ECC problems. But for these code based, lattice based and hash based and other things, underlying hard problems are used for designing crypto system. And today we do not have any quantum algorithm which can efficiently solve this kind of problem or can break this kind of system. So those are called quantum resistant cryptography. But tomorrow maybe we can have efficient algorithm for them also, but as of now we don't have any efficient algorithm. So these are basically classical only, but based on this kind of problems which are safe against quantum computer. And there is another domain that is called quantum cryptography, in which we use some quantum phenomena to do encryption. Okay, and these are perfectly safe in case of quantum computer is there or not there, whatever quantum techniques you have, because these are based on quantum physics laws. And so if you implement them properly, then we are safe, whatever resources adversary has. So this thing will be covered in detail in later sessions by other experts. So just to understand that these are classical ones only, but today we don't have any efficient quantum algorithm for them to break them. So we can use them, and these are based on quantum physics. So this will be secure for longer duration, but the cost of these devices is high. And if you see the progress in quantum computing, then tremendous progress has happened. So as I told already to you, in 1994, Shor's algorithm came. So it promises that it can break current ciphers, cryptographic schemes like RSA. So then this quantum development started. So you see, in 1998, we have a 2-qubit device. And if you see, in 2018, we are having 72-qubit device. So over 20 years, you see the progress is tremendous. And lots of countries, academia and companies have started investing huge money in designing quantum computers. So in designing quantum computers, different implementation strategies are there. How you are going to implement qubits? So to implement qubits, there are two things: superconducting and semiconductor quantum dot based techniques are there. So if you see here, major companies are investing in this superconducting thing, and it is promising that we can have large quantum computer with this superconducting circuit technology. And in India also, we have TIFR, which has demonstrated 2-qubit quantum device a few years back. And in the quantum dot also, IIT Bombay is working to design a quantum computer, or basically design qubits first and then design the quantum computer. So see the progress here, 2-qubit 2021. So on 16th of November last week, IBM announced that they have this 127-qubit device. So, and see the progress is tremendous, because if you compare the progress with classical computers, then it took several decades, or 4 or 5 decades to have what kind of devices you are having in your hand, like laptop or mobile tablets. So it took 4 or 5 decades to have this kind of system in your hand. But here, as you see, 1998 it started, and in 21 we are having this kind of quantum devices. So progress is very fast compared to classical. In particular, if you see, IBM has planned a development of quantum computers, and it is progressing very well. So If you see here, in 2021, they targeted for 127 qubit device, and this slide is older. Like it's not this year's slide; it's older slide. But they are able to deliver on their projected plan. So they plan to have 2021 with 127 qubit device, and that they delivered last week. So they are planning for higher number of qubit in there for the. So they will be planning that after 2023 they will be having these many qubits, and after that they will be having millions of qubit. And once we have this kind of large quantum devices, then we can do marvels. Like you can simulate efficiently various quantum mechanical system. You can simulate drugs. So whatever application I told, you can be that can be done on those kind of devices with millions of qubits. This was in 2019 when Google claimed that with their Sycamore quantum processor, which was having 54 qubits, they said that we are able to do some problem in 200 seconds on a 54 qubit device, which cannot be done on a that time quantum that time supercomputer is Summit. So it was 2019. So IBM was having this device Summit supercomputer, which was having 1 petaflop capacity. So Google says that it has a quantum device with 54 qubits, and it can solve a problem on this processor, which take only 200 seconds. But if you solve using the best compute supercomputer of that day, was IBM Summit, it will take 10,000 years. Okay. So in that case, whenever something which we can do on a quantum processor but cannot be done in reasonable time on a classical computer, then we can say we have achieved quantum supremacy. So in that paper in 2019, Google claimed that we have achieved quantum supremacy because the same thing will take 10,000 year on a supercomputer of IBM. Although IBM said, okay, with some optimization, we can reduce this time to several days. But the thing is that here this we have quantum advantage in solving some problem which is not solvable easily in reasonable time on a classical computer. So I'm running out of time. So this David scientist at IBM has said that certain properties are required for a quantum computer. It should be scalable means it should be able to have more qubits, and those should be addressable, can be initialized with the zero with precision. Okay, and those error rate should reliably read out should be also possible. Means these are some general guidelines are there that the quantum computer should be a good quantum computer should have, that it should have more qubits, reliable qubits with few noises and errors, and the readout should be reliable. And in the IBM has defined this term quantum volume. So what it says is that merely increasing the number of qubit will not make sense, because if you do not reduce the error. So here in this graph, if you see, whenever this error rate is low and more qubit, that will have more quantum volume. So because we are having quantum computers with variety of number of qubits, variety of errors from different companies with different underlying technologies, so how we can compare them? So IBM has proposed this quantum volume concept, where these two things are compared, taken into consideration: effective error rate and number of qubits. So whenever these two things, this effective error rate should be less and qubit should be more, then it will have a more quantum volume. And more quantum volume means the device can do reliable quantum computation, or can give speed up on classical compared to classical computer. So not merely increase the number of qubit, we should also be able to reduce the effective error rate. Okay, so this is the progress, or these are the key institutes which are involved in theoretical and experimental research in India. So you can see here in all vertical of quantum technologies like basic sciences, computing, communication, or quantum sensing, all of these academia are working, and there are many more. So they are working. And in last year, in the budget also, the finance minister announced that India is investing 8,000 crore rupees in quantum technologies. So there is a national mission on quantum technologies by government of India, wherein 8,000 crore over a period of 5 years will be given to for research and development in different verticals of quantum technologies. So there are tremendous opportunities are there in this field. And one of the challenges there is that in designing a quantum computer, there are this challenge of scalability, means how you can have more number of qubits. And the challenge here is that reduce this error. Of course, this error rate is significant and the qubit quality is not up to mark. So the challenge here is that you should have a scalable qubits system and with precise control over them. Qubit should have a longer shelf life, means they should not deteriorate over time. So in designing quantum computer, there are different engineering challenges are there. So those are being taken care and research is going on in designing a universal fault tolerant quantum computer, which will have millions of qubits and reliable qubits, means they will behave properly without any errors. And if there is an error, then there's quantum error correction mechanism will be there. So that will be reduced. So now so my talk is over. So any question is there? Vidya ma'am?
Sir, the participants can interact and ask queries.
Yeah.
Sir, good morning, sir. This is Dr. Atisha here. Sir, yeah, only one question, sir. You were talking about controlling the error rate, sir. Yes. So what will be the factor to be concentrated if we want to control the error rate?
Because one thing is that while you're designing the quantum computer, in the design or implementation phase of this quantum devices, engineers should take care. Second is that suppose we have 20 qubit quantum devices with us, then there is in this Qiskit, if you remember, that there is this module Ignis is there. So what it does is it kind of error characterization and mitigation it does. So let's suppose on measuring we are getting some errors. So if you measure the output certain time, we are getting few errors. So what we can do is we can calibrate those errors and can mitigate them using the Ignis module.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Any other question is there? So my recommendation,
sir, can you give some focus on the tunneling?
Tunneling effect?
Yeah, tunneling effect.
Yeah, quantum tunneling is an effect is used in adiabatic computation, quantum computation. And in that, what happens is that if you remember, So let's suppose some state is here, okay, or some particle, this electron is here, and there is this barrier, okay? And this barrier is, let's suppose, 5 millivolt or something. So until and unless this electron has this much energy, it cannot cross this barrier. It cannot cross this barrier and come at this side. But in quantum, there is this phenomena called quantum tunneling, in which out of, let's suppose, there are many electrons with less energy than this 5 millivolt, but out of those electrons, some electron can cross this barrier. And this is something called like tunneling kind of thing, that theoretically each electron should have this much energy to cross this barrier. But in practical quantum systems, some electron can pass through this barrier using this tunneling kind of phenomena with certain probabilities. So this has a computing application in adiabatic quantum computation by D-Wave. But the thing here is to understand that there may be some electron with some probability can cross without crossing this barrier. They can kind of tunneling is there in using the tunnel, they can pass through this barrier. So it's a quantum phenomenon. Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. Sir, I have one doubt. Is this related to like quantum entanglement phenomenon, sir?
Okay.
Sir, is this related? Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, is this related to entanglement or like tunneling has any relation with that?
No.
Okay.
We will be covering this quantum entanglement and quantum teleportation in my later session. So,
okay, sir.
Then we will see some practical aspect of that.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for this elaborate session about the area of quantum cryptography. And highlighting the topics like basics of quantum cryptography and quantum simulators, quantum search algorithms, and how the quantum era has grown up. All these you have highlighted in an elaborate manner. Thank you very much, sir. I also like to call upon one of the participants to show the gratitude. Dr. Atisha, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Yes, Dr. Vidya, ma'am. Also, on behalf of all the participants, I would like to thank Dr. Harish Sahu, scientist from DRDO, for his very much enlightening session on introduction to quantum computing. Really, I should say that when we entered this FTP, we didn't know any of the basics of quantum computing, even though we were hearing this topic for a long time. But his talk has actually brought us some interest in learning about this quantum computing. Really, I should say that he has set the platform in a very appropriate manner. And thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Harish. And thank you, Dr. Vidya, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Atisha, ma'am. And thank you, Vidya, ma'am. And thank you, participants, for patiently listening.
Dr. Harish, sir, will be available with us for another two sessions on Wednesday and Thursday. So thank you very much.